Mathematical reasoning, just like statistics, mathematical reasoning is a very sweet and simple chapter, and I think one question definitely comes on it. Mathematical reasoning. This chapter is based on basically the concept of logic, okay, or the concept of deduction, okay. So in logic, there are two aspects of validating a statement. One is by induction, another is by deduction. Induction is where from given instances, you are trying to generalize things. And deduction is where from generic things, you are trying to, you know, find an answer to a very specific case. Okay. So there are two parts of reasoning. One is called induction, other is called deduction. Induction is what you studied in your principle of mathematical induction. And deduction is what you are going to study in this chapter, which is mathematical reasoning. Okay. So in this chapter, we are going to, first of all, learn what are statements. Okay. What are statements? What are the different types of statements? Let me write them down. So the overview of the chapter is, we are going to talk about statements. Okay. Second is, types of statements. Okay. And their truth tables. Type of statements, we are going to talk about compound statement. Of course, simple statement is also there. Compound statement. If then statement. If and only if statement. Okay. Along with the truth tables of these. And finally, we are going to learn about validation of statements. Particularly validation of the last two, if then and if and only if. Okay. So this is what we have in this chapter. Not a very difficult one, very scoring. Mostly this is the important part of this chapter. Okay. So let's begin. First of all, statements. I think I've already told you before the difference between a sentence and a statement. Sentence versus a statement. So what is the difference between a sentence and a statement? Sentence is basically a collection of words which make a certain meaning. Okay. And sentence could be of four types. It could be a declarative sentence, which we call as sometimes assertive sentence. Okay. Sometimes you also call it as the proposition, where you try to declare something, right? For example, 3 is a prime number. Okay. So this is a declaration which I am making. This is an assertion which I am making. This is a proposition which I am making. Or let's say sun is a planet. Okay, that's what my daughter's teachers say. Sun is a planet, moon is a planet. I don't know for what reason they say so, but that's how very small kids have been taught. Sun is a planet. Okay, now these are declarative sentences. Now I may not be correct. For example, sun is not a planet. Sun is a star. If my geography is not that weak, sun is a star. Okay, so when I say something, it is just an assertion. I may be wrong in my assertion. Okay. Second type of sentence is imperative sentence. Imperative sentence. Imperative sentence is where I am making some requests or giving some command to somebody. Like switch on the lights. Or switch on the fan. Okay. Or please give me a glass of water. Or give me a cup of tea. Okay. So here I'm making some kind of a command or a request. Okay. So those are called imperative sentence. Means I'm trying to put a force on the person who is basically trying to listen to these commands. Third is interrogative sentence. Now my purpose is not to teach you English here, because many times in the JE exam, they ask you which of the following is a statement. Okay. Interrogative is where you're trying to question somebody. Okay. So how was your math paper? how was your maths exam? So I'm asking you a question. Okay. Why you did not appear for the last Kemon test? So these are interrogative sentence. The fourth one is an exclamatory sentence. Exclamatory sentence is where some kind of an exclamation is used, where you're trying to express some kind of an excitement, sorrow, joy. Okay. Like, let's say, wish you a happy birthday. Wish you a happy birthday. Or have a good day. Have a good day. Okay. So these are exclamatory sentences. Now, out of the sentences, those sentences which are first of all unambiguous. Unambiguous means there is no doubt about it. That means there is no element of uncertainty about it, and those which can be answered with a true or a false, but not both. So those statements which are unambiguous and can be answered with true or a false, but not both, are eligible to be called as statements. So statements are those type of sentences which are unambiguous and which can be responded with a true or a false, but not both. If you are responding any statement with both true and false, it actually becomes a paradox. Okay. So paradox is something which is can be both true and false. Let me write both true and false. Okay. So statement are those sentences which are unambiguous and which can be answered with a true or a false, but not both. So out of these four types of broader division of sentences, which of them can be called as statements? Can I call an exclamatory sentence as a statement? If I say, have a good day, will you answer this as a true or a false? Will you say true? I don't think so. You'll say thank you. Okay, and wishing you the same, right? It cannot be true or a false. I am nobody to decide whether when I say you have a good day, you will have a good day. You may have a bad day as well. Okay. Interrogative sentence. Can I call it as a statement? I don't think so. If I say, how was your maths exam? You'll say false. Huh? I don't think so. You'll reply with a false. You'll say it went well, or you'll say it didn't go well, or it didn't go as expected. Okay. So exclamatory sentence cannot be a statement. Interrogative sentence cannot be a statement. Imperative sentence. If I say switch on the fan, will you say true? Will you say false? You'll say yes, I will, or no, I won't. Right? Please give me a cup of tea. Will you say true? You'll say okay, yes, I'll get you a cup of tea, or no, I will not get you. So this cannot also be answered with a true and a false. But if I say a declarative sentence or a assertive sentence or a proposition, let's say 3 is a prime number, you'll say true. Yes, whatever you're saying is true. Okay, sun is a planet, false. So these type of sentences will be called as a statement. So this is only statement possible. Okay. Statements are normally in mathematics written by a small alphabet, P, Q, R, whatever you want to say. So let's say if I say sun is a star. Sun is a planet. By the way, I'll resume the same statement which I said in the previous slide. Is sun a star is an interrogative sentence. It is not a statement, Gayatri. You're not asserting something. You're asking something. No, it's a question. It's an interrogative sentence. So interrogative sentences are not statements. No. Is sun is a star, you don't say true for it. You say yes for it or no for it. Get the difference between yes, no and true, false. Are you getting my point? So when you say true, it's a fact. When you say false, right? It's not a correct statement. It's a false statement. But yes or no is something like you are willing to obey somebody or you're willing to answer somebody. Okay. When you say yes, do you think you're going to, yes is the correct thing for it? It could be maybe also, right? So when you ask a question, it is not a statement. When you assert something, when you declare something, when you propose something, that is a statement. So this is a basically a statement which I have denoted by a small alphabet P. Okay, you can use any alphabet. Not normally P is used, P for proposition. And there is something very interesting, negation. Negation of a statement is written by a tilde sign attached in front of it. Okay, I have seen P dash also been used or P bar also been used. But mostly you will see negation symbol being used. Negation is nothing but it is the opposite, or you can say, let's say sun is a planet. So negation of it is sun is not a planet. Okay, simple as that. Many a times some students write, it is not the case. It is not the case that sun is a planet. Okay, keep it simple. Now, when it comes to negation, there are certain questions which will be having quantifiers into it. Now, what is a quantifier? Let me just talk about it. There are two types of quantifiers. One is called a universal quantifier. Another is called an existential quantifier. Existential quantifier. What is a universal quantifier? All the statements which have got words like or phrases like all, every, okay, or none. Okay, so statements which begin with or have these kind of wordings in them, they are called universal quantifier. That means universal means all the objects come into it. So they quantify the entire object. For example, if I say all cats scratch, so I'm basically giving a universal quantifier to this statement where I'm including every cat existing on the planet, or for that matter universe. Okay, so I'm saying every cat in this universe will scratch. So this is a statement having a universal quantifier. There are some quantifiers which have words like there exists. I'm sure you would have heard this in maths also. Okay, there exists, or at least one. Okay, or some. So whenever a statement contains these kind of words or phrases, we say that the statement has got existential quantifier. That means there is an existence of certain objects which will satisfy that characteristic. For example, if I say there exists a prime number which is even. So yes, we know that 2 is a prime number which is even. Okay. Or there exists a person in this planet who is 8 feet 6 inches tall. Okay. Or some people in Karnataka speak Hindi. So these all statements are containing existential quantifier. So first of all, is it clear what is universal quantifier and what is existential quantifier? Now, when the statements begin with these quantifiers and when you are finding out its negation, please be very, very careful. For example, let me ask you this question. Let's say I give you a statement R which says all cats scratch. Can you give me the negation of it? I would like everybody to give me a response on the chat box. All cats scratch. Okay. Right. Now, many of you have given a wrong answer saying that all cats don't scratch or no cat scratches, etc. Please note that they're all wrong. The answer to this is at least one cat doesn't scratch. or there could be various versions of it. There exists a cat that doesn't scratch. Yeah, Vaibhav, that is also correct. Some people have said not all cats scratch. That is also fine. But normally we do not begin a statement with not all. Okay. Better to say some cats do not scratch. Right? So guys, this is a mistake which people do. When your statement begins with a universal quantifier, your negation should begin with a existential quantifier. Get this correct. So when you say all cats do not scratch, it is covered under this. So when you say all cats do not scratch or no cat scratch, they are all covered under these. Okay. So when I say all cats scratch, the negation of it is getting to me at least one cat which doesn't scratch. For example, if I give a statement, hey, all cats scratch. Tomorrow you come to me with a cat in your hand and say, sir, see this cat. Okay. No matter how much you tease it, it will never scratch you. And of course, I realize it doesn't scratch. So what I said will become wrong, or whatever I have said will become false. So even one instance you are able to show me where whatever I have said is going to fail, that means that statement is getting negated. Are you getting my point? So you don't have to show me all the cats in the world, right? And show me, sir, see, these all cats in the world don't scratch. That is fine. I mean, that is going to negate my statement. But even if one cat doesn't scratch, my statement gets nullified. My statement becomes false, invalidated. Are you getting my point? So here is a small concept for you. If a statement begins with a universal quantifier, its negation will be having existential quantifier and vice versa. Let's say, had I given you a statement that there exists a cat that doesn't scratch, then its negation would be all cats scratch. Getting the point? So please make a note of this. This is something which has been asked in JEE before. And let me pick up a question based on it. I think I forgot to take a question, but just give me a minute. I'll pull one out. Okay. So the question goes like this. Just a second. Statistics. Okay, I don't want to write actually. That's why I'm pulling out this question. Where is my question? Okay, there you go. I hope you can see this question. I'll do one thing. I'll just take a snapshot of this. Read this question carefully. S be a non-empty subset of R. Consider the following statement P. P says there is a rational number X which comes from this set S such that X is greater than 0. Okay. Which of the following statement is the negation of this statement? I'll put the poll on. Let's have 1.5 minutes. I think 1 minute is good enough. Think carefully and then answer. Think carefully and then answer. Okay, let's stop the poll. I think 11 of you have voted. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, go. Okay, most of you have said option number B, which is actually correct. Okay, so see, when you have there is a rational number. Basically, there is a rational number shows existential quantifier. Okay, this is an existential quantifier. So when you're asking for the negation of an existential quantifier, it must have a universal quantifier. So there is no is a possibility and every is a possibility. Both are universal quantifier. None or every, they are all universal quantifiers. Now, when you say there exists a rational number which is greater than zero, then of course you can say there is, or you can say every rational number is actually less than or equal to zero, and option number C becomes the right option. Are you getting my point? Okay. All right. Next, moving on to compound statements. What is a compound statement? Compound statement is basically a type of a statement which involves simple statements. So we are going to learn 4 types of compound statements in our today's session. The first is a compound statement where 2 statements are connected by AND operator or AND connector, which we call as conjunctions. Okay, what is a conjunction? Conjunction is basically when a simple statement P and a simple statement Q are connected by AND operator. Okay, symbolically we represent it as P up arrow Q. This is the same AND operator that you have actually learned in your Boolean algebra and computer science. Okay. So some examples I can give for this. Let's say 18 is divisible by 3 and 6. So if you see, this is made up of 2 simple statements connected by AND operator. So what are the simple statements here? So let's say I call this as R. So you can have one simple statement is 18 is divisible by 3. And another simple statement is 18 is divisible by 6. So when you connect these two statements, when you connect these two statements by a AND operator, it becomes your statement R. So now, when you are trying to compare two statements, so we say they are logically equivalent. Okay? So this is a symbol which is normally used when you are trying to show that two statements are logically equivalent. What is logically equivalent? Logically equivalent means they mean the same thing actually. Or mathematically speaking, they have the same truth table. Okay? So when two statements have same truth table, they are called logically equivalent. Okay? We'll talk about it in some time. But however, I just wanted here to make you understand that this is a compound statement and these are two simple statements which are connected by an AND connector. And these kind of statements are called conjunctions. These type of statements are called conjunctions. Now, let us talk about the truth table of conjunctions. Most of you already know that because you have done this in your junior classes or in some computer science course. So conjunctions are true only when both the input statements are true. If any one of the statement becomes false, conjunction becomes a false. Okay. By the way, if there are two statements involved in a conjunction, please note that there can be conjunctions between several simple statements. So you know that if there are two statements involved, then 2 to the power 2 inputs should be given, which is 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. If there were, let's say, three statements, P, Q, R, connected by, let's say, AND operator or AND connector, then 8 inputs will come. True, 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 false, true, false, true, true, then true, false, false, true, false, true, false, false, like that. 8 combinations will come. Okay? So this is the truth table of a conjunction. Any question about it? This is already known to most of you, so I will not waste much of your time. The next compound statement that we are going to talk about is a disjunction. Disjunction. Disjunctions are those statements where simple statements are connected by OR operator or OR connector. Now this OR is an inclusive OR. This OR is an inclusive OR. What is the meaning of inclusive OR? Inclusive OR means even if both of them can happen together. So both P and Q can happen together also. For example, if I say, let's say you're going out to buy something. Okay, so I say, okay, get me pastry or cake. Get me pastry or get me cake. That means even if you get both for me, I'll be happily accepting it. Okay, I'll be more than happy. I'm getting two things to it. But if I say something like this, the children are in the classroom or in the playground. Now this OR is an exclusive OR because the children cannot be simultaneously in the classroom and in the playground. Okay, they can only be at one of the places. So this is an example of exclusive OR. So what are we dealing here is inclusive OR. So we are talking about inclusive OR where both P and Q can happen together. Okay, symbolically we represent it by this symbol. So example, as I have already said, so I'll give you some mathematical example. Let's say 3 is an odd number or a prime number. Okay, so it is made up of disjunction of two simple statements. 3 is an odd number or 3 is a prime number. Okay, simple as that. Nobody has any problem in understanding it. Let's look into the truth table of it. So truth table for a disjunction looks like this. So at least one of them has to be true for the statement to be true. So true, true is true. True, false is true. False, true is true. But false, false is false. So at least one of them has to be true for the statement to be true. Okay. Now, coming to the negations of these two statements, which is very important. So negations of conjunction and disjunction. Negation of a conjunction and a disjunction follows the De Morgan's law. So if I say negation of P and Q, it is logically equivalent to negation P or negation Q. Right? Very much similar to what we had done in our sets. A intersection B complement is A complement union B complement. Okay? So basically, De Morgan's law is applicable to this as well. Negation of P or Q is logically equivalent to negation of P and negation of Q. Please make a note of this. Very, very important. These two are called the De Morgan's law. Okay. Now, I'll just show you the proof for one of them. I will draw the truth table. Let's say I draw the first one. I'll draw the truth table for the first one and show you that the truth table of this will match with the truth table of this. So let me just I can make one more. Yeah. So P, Q, negation P, negation Q, P and Q, negation P and Q. Oh, I think I need more. And finally, negation P or negation Q. Now, just watch out for the outcomes in these two columns. You will see that they will have the same truth table. So let's start. True, 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 false, false, true, false, false. So these are the four combinations of the input statement. Negation P means true negation is false, false, true, true. Negation Q will be false, true, false, true. P and Q will be true, false, false, false. Negation of this will be false, true, true, true. Now, negation of P or negation of Q. So you just have to OR it. So false or false is false. False or true is true. True or false is true. True or true is true. As you can see, they have the same set of outcomes. That means they have the same truth table. Same truth table means these two are logically equivalent. So they are same. So they are logically equivalent. That's why the symbol here I have used logically equivalent. Is it fine? So many times a question will come to prove whether two statements are logically equivalent or not, or which of the statement here is logically equivalent to the given statement. So please make truth table for those cases. Don't worry, we'll be taking questions on that. We'll be definitely taking questions on that. Is it fine? Any questions here? Any questions, any concerns? Okay. So before I move on, a quick word about the truth table. In some cases, you would realize that the truth table always comes out to be true, true, true for a given statement. Okay. A simple example of this could be P or not P. Okay. If I make a truth table for this, let's check it out. P, not P, P or not P. So let's say true, then this will be false. And this is false, this will be true. Correct? So if you take their OR, it will always be true, true. So you realize that the truth table is always containing true, true. In such cases, such statements will be called as a tautology. So what's a tautology? Tautologies are those statements whose truth table is always true. That means those statements are always true. They can never be false. Getting the point? On the same hand, if you have a statement whose truth table is always false, for example, rhyming with the same, P and not P. If you see P and not P, I don't want to make it again, I'll just write it over here. So if you see P and not P will always be false. Okay, so both answers are coming out to be false. So such statements are called fallacy. Fallacy, fallacy, contradiction, many words are given to it. Okay. Okay. Fallacy or contradiction. Okay. And statements which are neither tautology nor fallacy, statements which are neither tautology nor fallacy. I think I need to switch off my camera. It's becoming slow. Yeah. Fallacy. It is called a contingency. Okay. Contingency. So contingencies are those which have got both true false outputs coming out in the truth table. So direct questions have been framed in JEE where they will ask you, is this following or which of the following statements is a tautology? Okay, or which of the following statement is a contradiction? Okay, we'll take examples, don't worry, because I have few more cases to cover up and then we'll go on to some examples. So as of now, under compound statements, we have covered conjunction, truth table of conjunction, disjunction, truth table of disjunction, and negation of conjunction and disjunction. Is that part clear to everybody? Any questions? I hope you are finding this chapter easy, interesting, and it's very scoring, by the way. Nobody ever misses out solving a question on mathematical reasoning in the JEE main exam. So if you feel you do not like this chapter, then you are missing out on a sure shot 4 marker in your JEE main exam. Okay. Next, coming to the main important ingredient of this chapter, which is the third compound statement called if-then statement. If-then statement. If-then statement is also called unidirectional implication. Unidirectional implication. Okay. Now, why it is called unidirectional implication? You will come to know from the definition only. So when we say if P, then Q. So this is a typical example of an if-then statement. Or this is the structure of an if-then statement, right? So let's take an example. Let's say if you study hard, then you will qualify JEE. Okay. So here, this has two simple statements. So one is if you study hard. So you study hard is a simple statement. You will qualify JEE is another simple statement. Okay. So when two statements like this are connected by if-then statement, this is called a unidirectional implication. So a single arrow is used here, right? Because if this happens, then this will happen, not the other way around. Okay. By the way, P is called as the antecedent. Okay. Antecedent, also called as the hypothesis. Q is called the consequent, also called as the conclusion. Okay. So when you say P, single arrow Q, in English language, we read it as if P, then Q. Okay. P is called the antecedent. Antecedent means it will occur before. Consequent is it will occur as a consequence of it, or it will be an implication of it. So you studying hard, your implication will be you will qualify JEE. Are you getting my point here? So I hope it is clear what is if then and how it is represented. Okay. By the way, there are three associated terms associated with it. One is called converse of this is written as Q implies P. So when you switch the position of the antecedent and consequent, it is called the converse of this statement. By the way, they are not the same thing, right? They are not the same thing. How it is different, why it is different, we'll come to know from their truth tables. Don't worry about it. Second thing is inverse of if P then Q. Okay. This is written as if not P, then not Q. This is the inverse of if P then Q. And the third is, which you'll get to hear very frequently, is contrapositive of if P then Q. And that is written as if not Q, then not P. Please note this down. So this is read as if P then Q. Okay, and this is read as converse of if P then Q. This is read as inverse of if P then Q. And this is read as contrapositive of if P then Q. Okay. Any doubt, any concerns? Any doubt, any concerns, please do let me know now, right now, because this is one of the most important ingredients of this chapter. Almost 80% of the questions that you will see will be basically testing you on this. Okay. Now, let us look into the truth table. Yes, I can see some questions coming up. Could you explain it? Because I got disconnected for which part you want me to explain, Shraddha? If P then Q. This is called converse of if P then Q. This is called inverse of if P then Q. And this is called the contrapositive of if P then Q. Okay. P is called the antecedent. Q is called the consequent. Okay. So if the consequent and the antecedent positions are interchanged, you get the converse of that statement. Okay. If antecedent and consequent are both negated, you get the inverse of that statement. And if your antecedent and consequent are swapped and negated, you get the contrapositive of that statement. By the way, very interesting observation that you can see here is that the inverse of this is actually the contrapositive, or you can say, contrapositive of the converse. Okay, so this is the contrapositive of this statement. Okay. Inverse of if P then Q is the contrapositive of the converse of if Q then P. Getting my point? So see here. What is the contrapositive of this? Contrapositive of this is if not P, then not Q. And which is actually the inverse of this. Okay, so both these statements are logically equivalent. In fact, the same statement has to be logically equivalent. Okay, so let me write it. They're actually the same. In fact, same. Okay, we'll talk about all these things with respect to their truth table. With respect to their truth table, there are a lot of things to be learned through the truth table. So allow me now to go to the next slide where I'll be talking about the truth table of if P then Q. So in fact, I will make the truth table for all of them. But for that, you have to understand one of them. Others can be easily be replicated over here. So what I'll do, I'll make a big table. Okay. This is P. This is Q. This is not P. This is not Q. This is P implies Q. This is Q implies P. This is not P implies not Q. And finally, whatever is left off. Okay, so I'll write it down. So this is for P, this is for Q, this is for not P, this is for not Q, this is P implies Q, this is Q implies P, this is not P implies not Q, and this is not Q implies not P. Okay. Now all of you, please pay attention at least to the truth table of this. If you're able to understand the truth table of this, you'll be able to do all the three remaining ones very, very easily. Okay. So all of you, please pay attention. Very, very important. If P is true, let me first put the truth values that P and Q can take. Okay, so these are the four combinations. If P is true, Q is true. Then if P, then Q will be true. Correct? So let's say I give a statement to you that, hey, if you study hard, you will be clearing JE exam or you'll be qualifying JE exam. So let's say you studied hard and you cleared JE. Then will you come and say that, sir, whatever you said was wrong? Definitely not, right? You'll say, sir, whatever you said was right. I studied hard and as per your saying, I cleared JE also. Thank you. Whatever you said was true. Correct? But let's say you studied hard, you did not clear JE. Okay? God forbid this should happen. Okay? So if you studied hard and you did not clear JE, the first thing you'll come and say, sir, whatever you're saying was false. I put my heart and soul. I studied almost 10 hours a day. I did all your DPPs. I did all the study material. I took the test honestly. I analyzed my mistakes. I did my self-assessment test, but still I did not clear JE. That means whatever you were saying was completely wrong, sir. Isn't it? Yes or no? Isn't it? But let's say you did not study hard and you still cleared JE. Does it make my statement any false? Or whatever I said was still true? What do you think? Should I write true here or should I write false here? Okay, Rohan. Okay. So some are saying true, some are saying false. The answer here is my statement still holds to be true because I never said that if you don't study, you will qualify. So when your antecedent itself is not met, you have no right to judge the consequent. Are you getting my point? So my statement was, if you study hard, but did you study hard? No. So don't judge my consequent then. So my statement is still a true statement. It is still valid. Getting my point? This is one of the surprising factors of the truth table of if P then Q. Okay. If you did not study hard and you did not qualify JE, then is my statement true or is my statement false in that case? I would like to know your opinion. My statement is still true. Yes. Thank you, everybody. Yes, it is still true. Because you again did not study hard. You can't come and argue with me, you know. So my first thing is, did you study hard? Correct? You say no. Then my statement is still true, no? Are you getting my point? So the only occasion when my statement will become false is when you studied hard and you still did not qualify JE. That is the only time you will come and debate with me. You'll come and argue with me. Sir, whatever you said was wrong. But in rest of the occasions, you will not come to me. Or you'll come to me with a thank you. Are you getting my point? So this is very important. Now, when people ask me, sir, how to remember this truth table, I tell them a very simple analogy. I think I have told this to the NAFL students also. So let's say I make a statement. A husband promises his wife that if I get a promotion, then I will take you for Europe trip. Okay. So let's say there's a husband who makes a promise to his wife that if I get a promotion, that is, this is your P statement, then I will take you for a Europe trip. Okay, let's say this is your consequent. Now try to analyze, when is this husband a good husband? He gets a promotion, he takes his wife to Singapore, Europe trip. Is he a good husband? If the answer is yes, write a true there. If the answer is no, write a false there. Okay. So he getting a promotion and he keeping up his promise of taking the wife for the Euro trip means he's a good husband. So true for that. If he gets a promotion and he doesn't take his wife for the Euro trip, what do you think? Is he a good husband or a bad husband? Very bad husband, right? He did not fulfill his promise. So he is getting more money because he is promoted, but still he is a conjuice fellow. He is not taking his wife for the Europe trip. Okay. So he's a bad husband. Bad husband means false. Okay. Let's say if he doesn't get a promotion and still poor fellow takes his wife for the Europe trip. Okay. You'll say, sir, he's a god husband. Sir, he's a very, very good husband, right? Because even if he has no money, he's still taking his wife for the trip. So true there. Okay, just an interesting way so that you remember this truth table, else you will forget it. And let's say if he doesn't get a promotion and he doesn't take his wife, bichare ki kya galti hai? Usko promotion nahi mila, paisa nahi aaya, nahi leke gaya Europe trip. He's still a good husband. So true again. Getting the point? So please do not get surprised to see a true coming over here. I understand the first and the second situation. But many people forget the third and the fourth one. Okay. Now, in the same hand, we can write down the truth table for others also. So, first of all, let me fill up not P. Not P is false, true. Not Q will be false, true. Now, to fill this up, let us fill this up now. Treat this as the antecedent. Treat this as the consequent. Now, did not get promotion, did not take his wife for the Europe trip. Good husband. Did not get promotion, took his wife. Good husband. Got a promotion, did not take his wife. Bad husband. Got a promotion, took his wife. Good husband. Right? Similarly, for writing the truth table for this one, treat this as your consequent, treat this as your antecedent. Treat this as your antecedent. Treat this as your consequent. Okay. So now, true. False, true. See, didn't get a promotion, took his wife for Europe trip. True, false. False, true. Okay. Are you getting this point? Now, let's fill up this one. Now, treat this as your antecedent, treat this as your consequent. Didn't get promotion, didn't take his wife. Good husband. Got promotion, did not take his wife. Bad husband. Did not get promotion, still took his wife. Good husband. Got the promotion, took his wife. Good husband. Okay. Now, why I made all these four truth table in one go is I wanted you to appreciate the fact is that the truth tables of these two are same. Do you see that? They have the same truth table. Correct? Yes or no? That means this statement is logically equivalent to saying this. A very, very important concept. A lot of concepts are based around this. If P, then Q is equivalent to saying, if not Q, then not P. That means when I say if you study hard, then you will qualify JEE is equivalent to saying you will not qualify JEE if you do not study hard. Got this point? So a statement or if then statement is logically equivalent to its contrapositive. And at the same time, you would realize that the truth table for these two are same. Okay, that means Q implies P is logically equivalent to not P then not Q. Guys, essentially we are saying the same things. Here just P and Q positions are inversed. Okay, so the alphabets gets changed, but essentially I'm trying to say that a particular if then statement is always equivalent to its contra positive. Okay. Q to P again. Okay, Vignesh. See, Q to P, you treat this as your antecedent, the promise made by the husband, and this as your consequent, whether he takes his wife for the Euro trip or not. So, see here. Gets promotion, take his wife. Good husband. Doesn't get promotion, takes his wife. Again, a good husband. Gets promotion, doesn't take his wife, then he's a bad husband. Doesn't get a promotion, doesn't take his wife, still a good husband. Got it? Got it? Vignesh? Okay. Now, this is another platform where I want you to understand that the truth table of these two are not the same. That means if P then Q is not logically equivalent to if Q then P. Now, this is very important because as youngsters, let's say ninth grader, especially me, I mean, I'll tell my story. I always used to frown at my teachers when they used to prove the converse separately. Right? I'm sure most of you would be doing it. And most of you would be thinking that your teacher is just, you know, doing the same thing in, you know, reverse direction or something like that. But actually, no. She was actually right in proving the converse separately, because if this is true, it needn't mean this is true. Or if this is false, it needn't mean this is false. Okay? So these two are not logically equivalent. That is why in our junior classes, if you study, if you recall your circles chapter, etc., where you had learned several circles properties, you would you see that even if you visit those books right now, you'll be seeing that they will prove the converse also. Okay. So I used to feel very irritated. Why they are proving converse? It is the same thing. No, it is not the same thing. Had it be the same thing, their truth tables would have been the same over here. They are not the same, by the way. Got the point? Any question, any concern? So now, before going for a break, quickly talking about the negation of if P then Q. Negation of if P then Q is given by P and not Q. That means these two are logically equivalent. Please note this down. So negation of if P then Q is given by P and not Q. Please, before going for a break, verify this by truth table. All of you, please verify this by truth table. I'm giving you around 90 seconds time. Not a big thing to do. So make a truth table for this guy. Make a truth table for this guy and check whether the truth tables are matching or not. If matching, tell me matching on the chat box. How are you finding this chapter? Maza aa raha hai? Easy? Easy. Okay, Archit, thank you for confirming that. That was quick. Okay, Rachita. Okay, Rohan. Good, Gayatri. Okay, let's quickly do it. I don't want to take too much time. I think I need P, I need Q, I need one for negation Q. I need one for. Acha, I'm drawing everything, but it is up to you. You can skip something because in JEE it is not. They don't see your steps, so you can be. You can skip out some columns also, but do it at your own risk. And lastly, P and not Q. Okay, so let's put the inputs. True, false, false, true, false, false. Negation here will be false, true, false, true. Okay, now remember, husband making promise to the wife. Gets promotion, takes his wife, good husband. Gets promotion, doesn't take his wife, bad husband. Doesn't get promotion, takes his wife, good husband. Doesn't get promotion, doesn't take his wife, good husband. Okay. So by in some time you will remember this truth table as well. Okay. Negation of this will be false, true, false, false. Okay. Now, conjunction of this and this. True, false, false. True, true, true. False, false, false. False, true. False again. What do you see? Yes, exactly the same truth table. No difference. Okay. So they are same. So yes, it is logically equivalent. So I did two things over here. I first of all told you the negation also, and at the same time I basically tested you on your truth table making skills. Okay, so let's have a small break. On the other side of the break, we'll talk about if and only if, and then we'll take up some questions from the previous year JEE exam. Okay, all of you enjoy your break. Okay, some of you are back. Good. All right. So in the interest of time, we'll continue with the last type of compound statement, which is called if and only if. Okay. If and only if statement are also called as biconditional implication. They're also called as biconditional implication. Okay. So when you say if and only if P, then Q. Okay. IFF basically is a shortcut, or you can say an abbreviated version of if and only if. So if and only if P, then Q. Basically means that both implies each other, right? It actually means both are logically equivalent to each other. So this will mean this and this will mean this. That means both are the antecedent and the consequence of one another, right? So as an example, if I say, if and only if, I give, let's say, I take a name, Mr. X, banana, then he will eat. Okay. So what does this mean? It means that if you do not give banana to Mr. A or Mr. X, he will not eat. Or if he's eaten, you must have given Mr. A banana. Okay. So the fact that he has been served banana is equivalent to saying that he has eaten. And the fact that if you do not give him banana, he will not eat. Are you getting my point? So both implies one another. So he eating, or you giving him banana, is equivalent to his eating. Okay. And he eating is equivalent to you giving him banana. Okay. So this kind of statement can be broken down as two if then statements connected by a and operator or an and connector. So this and this basically will make your this statement. So you can say this is logically equivalent to saying this. Okay. No, if you give him a banana and if he doesn't eat, then these, you cannot say if and only if P then Q. Got it, Prakul. So if you give Mr. X banana and if he refuses to eat, then this statement P and this statement Q are not equivalent to each other. That means you cannot say if and only if P then Q. Or in other words, it will become false. Got the point? So if he is given banana, he will definitely eat it. He cannot refuse to eat. Okay. So if you look at this definition, you can actually make the truth table for if and only if P then Q. So let's make a truth table. So, oh, sorry. Let me use my tools. P, Q, P implies Q, Q implies P, and finally the statement. So P, Q, P implies Q, Q implies P, and the AND of these two. The AND of these two is basically what is your if and only if P then Q. So this is same as saying, if and only if P then Q. So let's see the truth table. True, 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 false, false, true, false, false. So this will be true, this will be false, this will be true, this will be true. Here, treat Q as the antecedent, P as the consequent. So true, true, false, true. Now you have to take the AND of both of them. So true and true is true, false and true is false, true and false is false, true and true is true. Got this point? So here the conclusion is, unless until both are true or unless until both are false, the statement will always be false. So only when both are true, it is true. Only when both are false, it is false. Rest, if any one of them is true and other is false, if and only if P, then Q will become false. That means if you give him banana and if he refuses to eat, then this statement will not be equivalent to this. That means this will be a false statement. Okay? And if you do not give him banana and he still goes and eat something, then also your statement will become false. Does it make sense to you? Does it make sense to you? Okay. Now, if I have to write the negation of such a statement, let's say I want to write down the negation of if and only if P then Q, it is as good as saying you are writing the negation of P implies Q and Q implies P. Correct? Now remember, when two statements are connected by an AND connector, the negation of it will follow De Morgan's law. That means it will be negation of if P then Q or negation of if Q then P. And individually, we have seen the negation of this, which is P and not Q. Or this is Q and not P. Okay. So this is your negation of if and only if P then Q. Now, do you have to remember this? If you want, you can remember. Else, you just have to remember the definition of if and only if P then Q. And then use your normal negation rules of De Morgan's law and get the result. Okay. Please note it down. Now, the last part of this chapter is a theoretical concept which probably would be asked to you in schools. I would like to know from NPS RNR students, have you done the three types of validity tests for if-then statement in your school? Direct method, contrapositive method. Oh, this chapter is deleted only. Okay, so what we'll do, we'll not go into that because if that is not coming, then it is not going to help you in the JEE exam. Okay, so we'll directly take some questions from the previous year papers. Just few of them, not more. This is JEE Main 2019 question. It says that, if you are born in India, then you are a citizen of India. What is the contrapositive of this statement? I would like to know from you on this poll. One minute to answer this. This is super, super easy. Come on, guys. Nobody should leave it. Very good. Okay. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, go. Okay, so A and D have got most number of votes, but remember, one of you is wrong, one of you is right. See, if you are born in India, if P, then you are a citizen of India, then Q. Remember the contrapositive of this statement. The contrapositive of this is not Q implies not P. That means if you are not a citizen of India, then you were not born in India, or you are not born in India, which is basically said by option number A. The last one, if you are not born in India, then you are not a citizen of India, is actually the inverse of the statement. Okay. Get the difference. That's why I wrote them categorically. Converse, inverse, contrapositive. Okay. So remember, this is the contrapositive. Again, I would write it down. This is contrapositive. This is called converse. This is called inverse. Okay. Next. Which of the following statements is not a tautology? Which of the following statements is not a tautology? Let's have 2.5 minutes for this. Very good. Got a response. Okay, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, Cool. Okay. Most of you have gone with C, option C. Okay, let's check. See guys, let's look at the first one. P and Q implies not P or Q. Okay. What we'll do is we'll make some truth tables out of it. Let's say we make some truth tables. P, Q, let's see whatever we require. We require P, we require Q, we require P and Q, I can see. We'll require P or Q also. Okay. And I think, this was Q. Okay. And what else we require? We require not P, not Q also. We should have made that before. Okay. True, 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 false, false, true, false, false. This is false, false, true, true, false, true, false, true. P and Q will be true, then false, false, false. This will be true, 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 false. Okay. Now, not P or Q. Not P or Q. So this will be true, false, true, true. Now P and Q implies this. So true, 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 false is true, false, true is true, true. So this is a tautology. So this cannot be your answer. Okay. So at the same time, I'll keep deleting this because what I don't need, I'll just keep on erasing this. So this is not your answer. Next is P and Q implies P. P and Q implies P. So true, true is... I'll write it down. So this is true, 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 false, true, true, false, false, true, false, false, again true. So this is also a tautology. So B cannot be your answer. Right? B is also a tautology. Okay. Next. P implies P or Q. So this is your antecedent. So P implies P or Q. So true, 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 again true, false, true, true, false, false is true. So this also cannot be your answer because this is a tautology. Correct? Okay. All right. So let's erase this. Now I think I need to make one more for the last one, which is P or not Q. P or not Q. So P or not Q. So true or true is true. True, false, true. Now we have to do P or Q, this and this. We have to do, which is the last, let me write it as D. So true and true, 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 false, false. Now here itself it is false, means it is not a tautology. Option number D is correct. So as you can see, this question took us a little time. And hence, when you're doing such questions, please write minimalistic steps. Okay, do not write all the things. it'll lead to a big table and you'll get confused in that table. Is it fine? Any questions here? So one last question we'll take, and then we will move on to introduction to 3D geometry. Simple question. I think you should be able to answer it within 30 seconds. The negation of the statement, if I become a teacher, then I'll open a school. Five, four, three, two, one, go. Aha. A and C only. C, guys. Why C? Arre, I already told you. If P, then Q. Negation is P and not Q. That means I will become a teacher and I will not open a school. Option number A. It's already written in this language. If P, then Q. Negation is P and not Q. P is what? I will become a teacher. Q is what? I will open a school. So negation is I will become a teacher and I will not open a school. Why are you making mistakes? Nobody drops these kind of questions here. They are very simple. Simple question. AIEEE 2011 question. There are three statements here. Suman is brilliant. Suman is rich. Suman is honest. What is the negation of Suman is brilliant and dishonest if and only if Suman is rich? 1 minute for this. Yeah, it's very obvious. Good. Everybody should get the same answer. Okay, five, four, three, two, one, go. Go, 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 go. Okay. Though many of you have answered A, which is correct, but I'm disappointed with people answering C and D. So Suman is brilliant. Suman is brilliant. And dishonest. If and only if Suman is rich, we have to write the negation of this. The moment you say this, option number A becomes correct. By the way, the positions of these two doesn't matter because both are antecedent and consequent of each other. So even if you write it like this, hardly makes any difference to the statement. Okay. So there is nothing like converse and inverse, etc. in a if and only if statement. Okay. So as you can see how easy questions are asked in this chapter, and this is indeed a very scoring chapter, and as all good things should come to an end, this chapter is also coming to an end. Okay. All right.